No mistakes this week about me being mistaken for someone's other halves, I hope, those of you on the last call. Okay, so a bit of an update, just a COVID update, and obviously talk about the events from the weekend. But as of this moment, we have 712 confirmed cases of COVID. We have 14,500 residents being shielded. Pupils now physically attending school, 1,672. When we look at the social implications as well, council tax reduction applications, the total number since the 28th of February, 4,700. And the implications of that, clearly what's happening in the incomes of our population, but also you bleed that over into implications for local council revenues and our financial challenges. Business grants awarded were up to 6,774, 6,800, may as well say. Food aid packages delivered by our own community service, 7,678. Calls to We Are Bristol last week, 105. Number of people emailing for help, 101, and the number of volunteers still up around 4,000. So those are some of the indicators that we've been using just to kind of track. There are other indicators we can share with you, but those are the interesting indicators that we've been using to track what's going on with COVID. I suppose the COVID story of the moment is just about our transition away from the strict lockdown. At this moment, how we manage that. Our schools have started to receive more pupils, obviously not all pupils, but as we've been clear from the start, we recognise the need to respect that our different schools are working in very different contexts, balancing very different risks. Some schools have a large number of pupils who are at home, who will be fine at home. They'll have a desk in their bedroom and get all the support. Other schools will have a large number of children for whom home is not the safest place, or maybe struggling to eat. And we have had some representation from children's groups raising real concerns about the welfare of children who are not in school in certain circumstances. Now, you can understand schools serving different constituencies will be balancing different risks that will impact on the decision they make about who and at what pace to take back in, as well as the technical challenges of managing their buildings, enabling social distancing, and so forth. So our argument has been from the start, as in other cities, the best people to trust is our local schools with their governors, parents, and to back them in that decision and to help them cope the consequences of their decision. If they don't take children back in, we need to support them reaching out with that pastoral support for those children that are at home. If they do take children in, we need to work with them to make sure they're best placed to manage their physical space and to take care of their workforce. We've been opening up facilities in our parks, the concession stands, the sports areas as well. We've been issuing guidance on social distancing for people in those spaces. I think we really pleased the Basketball Association, who had a bit of a coordinated lobby campaign recently, and we're on my Facebook Live, so they'll be able to get out and play basketball again. But we are issuing that guidance. The pandemic is still with us. We don't have a vaccine. We should not get overconfident too quickly, or we could be subject to a second wave. And then obviously non-essential shops have begun opening as well, and businesses have been in touch with us about taking people back in the workplace. We've been working with our economic recovery task force in Bristol under the city office to support businesses opening up for safety of their workforce in terms of public transport, but also how they manage their workplaces also. We do recognise that some businesses are now actually asking big questions about whether people will actually need to come back to city centre workplaces. There are some that have found out that efficiency has been good, staff welfare has been good with people working from home. So we anticipate as well within the business community, and employers in general, a conversation about the future of work patterns. But people are coming back to work, and we need to support people to do that safely. So we're just asking people just to be very wary, to continue with the guidelines. Okay, hygiene, social distancing, working from home when you can, staying home as much as you can as well. But we respect the fact that people continue to come out. And obviously with our public health team, the test, track, trace system needs to be made to work. And also we're also setting up our team in Bristol for any local outbreaks that we might have to deal with. Also over the weekend, obviously we had the Black Lives Matter rallies in Bristol. I was clear beforehand and during the event itself. If I just bring all those messages together, one is I can't condone criminal damage. I clearly cannot. And I raised concerns about social distancing and mass gathering. That was clearly, as I, it goes without saying that I am a supporter of Black Lives Matter and everything that means. And I've shared that with various ones among you before, that I am very concerned about the potential consequences of the risks that come into play through mass gatherings. And with the added dilemma that black and brown people are dying disproportionately from COVID and are paying a disproportionately high economic price as a result of the lockdown. So you face this real kind of dilemma of the need to take action on racism in general, inequality, racism in particular, inequality in general, but knowing that the actions being taken are likely to disproportionately harm the people we're trying to release from those hierarchies and those missed opportunities. Obviously, we had the statue taken down. You know, I've been again repeated in my message that, you know, this is a huge moment. Now, whether you support the statue being torn down and thrown in the harbour, or whether it fills you with concern and uncertainty, or whether you absolutely oppose it and think it was a horrific thing to do, it was a big moment for Bristol. That is just self-evident. Our challenge now as a city leadership is to hold those different experiences of Bristol together and make sure that for those that are celebrating, for those that are in fear, and for those that are really angered by it, we are a city that holds, that is able to hold those experiences together and try to find some common ground. That doesn't mean that we get everyone to the same view, but it does mean we create a city in which people have the ability to live with a difference, because their different experiences of Bristol, different perspectives are respected. Either way, we just need to find a way forward. One of the things we are going to be doing in Bristol, as we see what's happening around the world now as well, but one of the things that we'd intended to do, and we are doing, I've spoken to some local historians, is to pull a group of historians together, drawing on the firepower, you know, that intellectual firepower of our two universities. They won't just be historians, but they will be built around historians, to review and to look at Bristol's history. This is not political. It's not emotional. It's about good history and good academics. So to look at Bristol, to look at our monuments, our names, how we understand, how we communicate, how we celebrate and recognize our history. And with that Bristol group of historians, to bring that history to the city. How the city then begins to grapple with that is the next stage on. But I think one of the things that we must do is to get some, to do some real top quality understanding of the key events that have shaped this city, and how we understand those events and how we relate to who we are today. But I stress, this is not political, it's not emotional. It's about releasing academics into Bristol to help us understand who we are and how we've become, who we are and how we've got to become who we are today. And I think that the weekend's events, whether you like them or not, create that space for us to, and actually compel us to go on that launch that piece of work. So as ever, as Saskia said, you're free to ask me about any of that or any other things you might wish to ask me. Sorry, can I just request some water? I'm drying up here. Is anyone out in the office, Saskia?
Yeah, I'll get you some water, 2 seconds.
Thank you.
Who would like to go first? Adam, we don't often have you first. Would you like to come in?
Hello, Marvin. Hello, everyone. Yeah, I mean, obviously the big thing is the statue. Really three related questions. What will happen to the site now? What will happen to the bit of plinth with Colson's name on it that we understand the council removed yesterday? And will the public have any say in what happens to the statue and the plinth or a possible replacement monument?
Well, your third question answers the first two, really. It's absolutely essential that the city have the chance to have ownership of what we do with that public space. That's where actually where I think when I talked about the role of, you know, commissioning that group of historians to begin looking at Bristol, it, in many ways it's about equipping the city with that series of city events, city themes, you know, our self-awareness of ourselves, to be able to make sure we can have that conversation in a really, you know, really informed way, which is why it's important that work is not political or emotionally driven. It is just about good academics. And then off the back of that, we can then hopefully decide as a city what we want to do with that space. I would say that one of the most important skills we need to develop, and qualities we need to develop as a city, is the ability to live with difference. Like, you know, something I've said already, it's not getting to a point where we're all the same or we all think the same or we're trying to get everyone to think the same. It's about the ability to live with difference, because that's what we are. And when a decision is made about the future of our site, a decision will be made. Some people won't agree with it, but if we follow the process that's shown respect for the diversity of lives and experiences of Bristol, then hopefully, even if it's not what some would have wanted, as inevitably it won't be at some point, they can respect the fact that we've gone through a just, inclusive process to get to the point of making that decision. But that's not a journey I think we should hurry on. I think it's going to take some time to get there.
Ellie, would you like to ask a question next?
Yeah, thank you. Hi, Marvin. Hi, everyone.
Hi.
Just carrying on that theme first, if that's okay. The collective of historians that can be brought together, have you got kind of an idea of where that will go? Will it be something that will run through the institutions in the city and schools, education, everything? Will it culminate in a kind of physical venue? I wrote this morning about plans for a boat that could look a little bit something like celebrating some of the city's history, or properly marking that and celebrating Black creatives. Just kind of wondering where it could go.
So I'm actually going to be quite light touch on it. What I want to do is get, you know, convene this group of, it's not just going to be historians, by the way. Actually, one of the historians I've spoken to said we need more than historians. We also need potentially sociologists, people with that kind of academic expertise on placemaking, because there is something about how you physically put places together and craft them. So I'm going to be pulling together, you know, a bit of a Zoom with a few thinkers from our universities, you know, about this, and say, well, can you help me organise this and say who needs to be around the table? I have enough people already with an appetite. I won't share their names at the moment. We will share their names eventually, but I don't want to embarrass anyone at this stage. But there is a real appetite to do it. So once we've pulled those together, it will be a group that begins to form itself. And I think that's important too. What we want to do is release that energy, not trying to control it. So that group of historians and other academics come together and then help us understand who we are as a city, and help us, you know, in making decisions about how we use our public spaces to continue to express who we are, and not just who we are in the moment, because we always want to be better than what we are today, who we want to be in the future. In terms of the future of the statue, we will obviously retrieve the statue. We, you know, it's a bit of a technical process. We have to get a diver and, you know, and some such. So that work is being organised now. And then it will be taken to one of our museums.
And are you thinking that Zoom meeting will be public or not initially?
Well, it won't in the first instance, because it would just be an organising meeting. It will be okay, asking people who may want to be involved to come round to find out what it looks like, how much time they can give, and to help to design that process. So we would have to work. I mean, I'm not an academic, you know, I'd like to talk to them about how we would go about designing a process to harvest that academic expertise that we can then make available. I think the point you made is a very strong one, and one I thought too, that if we were doing that, it'd be an incredible opportunity, an incredible resource for Bristol schools. As that material is being put in the public domain, and material for our school children to be engaged with a live piece of work in a city that is self-reflecting, self-discovering, would be incredibly rich.
Cool, thank you. Have I got time for one more?
I'm fine. I apologise for being late. We were just bouncing around. I'm conscious that Adam may have had another one as well. Like, we jumped off here, but yeah, I'm fine for the moment.
So this is just going back to something came up in the accounts, but a week or so ago, and it's the consultants' fees. There's one in particular, Nigel Greenhay, who was paid just over £230,000 for a year, which is quite a bit more than most senior officers, consultants. Just interested in the justification for that, and whether he's also still in the role.
So we can, Nigel's no longer working with us, but there are things that need to be taken into account here, because the cost of a role is not just what someone gets paid, it's all the on costs that go with it. So when we do have someone as a consultant, we're not paying holiday pay, sick pay. They're only paid for the hours that they're here. So on paper, it looks like that. But when you compare it to our other staff as well, it comes in line. I think, you know, I understand as well when people look at the numbers, and I do too. It's not a world I've lived in. But if you add up the value of the developments that are at play in Bristol, we've got a £500 million university campus behind the train station. We've got a Temple Meads that we want to redevelop, and that's being worked on, including by Nigel. There's 150 to 200 million pounds. You've got the LNG scheme on Temple Island. That's 350 million pound plus. We're bringing forward the wider plans for St. Philip's Marsh, which you can, you know, on the basis of those three sites in that immediate proximity as well, you just begin to add up the developmental value of those sites. And then obviously what we're looking at in Western Gateway and the work around flood defence. I mean, you're very clearly, and on our mass transit system that is, you know, looking at £4 to £4.5 billion at this stage, you are talking about billions of pounds worth of regeneration. And for the confidence, you know, of our partners, our investors, you know, that is work that actually needs an expertise and that expertise doesn't actually come cheap, as much as I would like it to. It doesn't. And I think slight comment, because I did see the tweet from Martin about this. You know, one of the things that you also, it would be worth doing is going to other cities that we have looked on with envy that have got stuff done, like Cardiff, like Manchester, like Birmingham, and look at the number as it lands in Bristol. But also it might be worth looking at some of those other cities about, you know, what it's cost to get the developments, to get the housing, to get the arenas and all the other things that they've got done that we've said, why can they do it and we can't? It really can't be done on change. I wish it could, but it can't. And I shared with someone the other day, you know, if I was managing a football team, I could spend my time saying it is absurd how much we play professional footballers. And I could make a commitment to paying League Two wages, but then I'd get a League Two team. You know, if you want to be in a premiership, unfortunately, as horrific as these numbers sound, you have to begin, you have to work with it. You can either try and get that stuff done for the good of the city, or you can try and, you know, take on the wider system. Now, we're trying to do both at the same time. But in the meantime, people in Bristol need us to build the houses. We need the infrastructure. We need the transport. We need the new university campus as a catalyst for development. As I said, the numbers are challenging, but unfortunately, it's the world we're in rather than the world we'd like it to be. And it's what we have to do to get stuff done.
Thank you.
Richard, would you like to come in with a question? I'm guessing that this account for the ITV West Country one's not actually working. Is it just you?
It's me and ITV West Country recording it.
Ah, perfect. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. They're just recording it for a copy because my laptop at home might not be able to cope with a long press conference. Thank you. Hi, Marvin and everyone. Thanks for the opportunity. Just wanted to establish, first of all, it has been confirmed that the statue is in the council's ownership, is it? Because there was some confusion yesterday, just checking that that is your property, the council's property.
It hasn't been 100% established yet. We have obviously been caring for it, but actually there are questions about whether it is the council's property. Our legal team are looking at that now.
Okay. So I imagine that'll be established pretty soon.
Which we're moving as quick as we can. We need to, yeah.
And have you made an official complaint to the police about the destruction of the statue?
Well, we need to work out who owns the statue first and where that responsibility lies, and then that will be the, you know, that would be the next step when we know.
What do you think should happen to those who pulled it down and threw it in the harbour?
Well, that is in sub judice. I mean, it wouldn't be responsible for me to comment on that now. We've got to let the process work itself out, establishment of ownership, the statement. And, you know, we're in conversation with some of the groups in the city who are most associated with Colston and the Bristol establishment, to put it like that, about the best way forward for the city.
Could you say what you think of the actions of the people who did that? You said you sympathised. I don't know if that's the right word, but
no, we have to be very careful about
their emotion.
Yeah, no,
no one's been arrested or charged yet, have they?
Yeah, Richard, you have to be really careful because I'm quite careful about what I say here, right? What I've said is I cannot condone criminal damage. I'm a political leader of the city, and that's clear.
It
I cannot and I will not
crime,
condone criminal damage, right? At the same time, what I would say is I would never pretend to you, and I think you would quite rightly call me out if I was to stand here and say that the statue was anything other than an affront to me and that I had any sense of loss it being removed from the city. I can't pretend, and I won't pretend that that's not something inside me. And I've been involved with groups. I made a documentary for BBC actually back in 2007 in which I did a piece to camera from the statue with the plaque calling Colston a wise and virtuous son of the city. So obviously, you know, it's a point of pain for me. But I think the bigger question is not necessarily about the individual perpetrators. It's about what this means for Bristol and how we as a city go forward. As I shared at the beginning, there's huge risk and there's huge opportunity for us in this. We have people celebrating the pulling down of the statue. We have people who may be somewhat neutral about the statue itself, but are really concerned about the way it was done and what that means for their future. It gives them uncertainty and maybe have a degree of fear. And then we have other people who are horrified at the statue being pulled down and very angry about it. And I've got communications from all of those people. You know, what happens to the individuals, you know, is important, but it's secondary. The real issue is, how do we build a city in which all those perspectives, those people with those perspectives, feel that Bristol is their home and is interested in them? That's the challenge. That's the conundrum we have to take on that.
In hindsight, do you wish it had come down before from administration?
I wish it had come down years ago.
Past
but let
present.
Me just say, I mean, I dealt with this come up on Points West the other day. But, I mean, there is an interesting conversation, right? If having been elected the first, you know, African heritage black mayor in Europe, that suddenly the statue was my fault. After all these years and all these administrations and all these, you know, that would be a kind of political contortion. And as I shared also, you know, my commitment has been on inequality within the Bristol, as you know, I think is known, and some people have tried to make it a negative about me. You know, what have I been trying to do on race inequality in particular, inequality in general, affordable homes, feeding programs, children's mental health, tackling transport poverty, work experience for kids, period poverty. You know, when I think about all the things I could expend my political capital on in Bristol, taking a statue down from my administration was not top of that list of priorities. It was those real substantial issues that underlie our society that have left black communities in particular, all communities in general that are poor, disproportionately vulnerable to the consequences of COVID. So that's been our priority. But it's not a secret that I would I was not a fan of the statue being on the plinth in the middle of the city, but it wasn't my priority. In terms of what previous administrations have done, that's a question for them.
Yeah, of course. And I know, obviously, as mayor, you do have executive power to have removed it any time in the last 4 years. Obviously, you've had other priorities, but you that could have been done, I suppose. You do accept that.
But Richard, I'm going to challenge you here, and I hope you receive. I know sometimes people are sensitive, but I'm going to challenge you. It's quite a naive line of questioning.
Okay.
So I could have expended a lot of.
It's a question lots of people are asking.
Okay, fine, and that doesn't mean it's not a naive line of questioning.
A lot of people in Bristol are asking that naive question.
Well, a lot of people are not too. And talk to a lot of people, Richard, I don't want to end up in a ping pong with you. I'm just saying it's a question, okay? Yeah. So let me. I'll share with you a couple of things. Right. I've explained to you that we've got some real issues of substance in the city that are not solved by me taking the statue down. People do not live in symbolic acts. They do not eat symbolic acts. They are not educated by symbolic acts. They do not have their bills paid by symbolic acts. My priority in Bristol is to look at the very real challenges of Bristolians, all Bristolians, whether those, but also the drivers of inequality, and to tackle those. That takes political capital to enter into the debate and the contest over the statue would have been an all-consuming political act, because I'm sure as a well-worn journalist in the city, you are aware of the level of controversy there is around that statue. And you can imagine, and I don't think you need to imagine, you can anticipate the amount of political heat there would have been if I'd entered into taking that statue down, a heat that would have taken our energies away from tackling those issues of substance. Is that an analysis you would recognise as being fair?
Sorry, the line is breaking badly. I think I'm sure it's my connection. It's not yours, but my internet connection is breaking badly. Okay, so, I apologise for that, but okay, I didn't catch the end.
So the point is, I could have expended a lot of political capital on a statue entering into a symbolic act that wouldn't have actually fed, clothed or paid any bills for people in Bristol. The other dynamic around that would have been in play there would have been that I'm a black mayor. And it would have been that the first thing a black mayor does is not come in and deal with issues of political substance, economic substance, not balancing the budget, not dealing with the consequences of, of austerity, of budget shortfalls, of the financial mess we inherited, of the Bundred Review, of our ownership of commercial companies. The first thing a black mayor does is not to do issues of political and economic substance, but it's to come in and do issues of symbolism, and highly controversial symbolism as well. That wouldn't have been wise political leadership. So I chose to focus on issues of substance. Now, that is not to say that symbolic acts are not important, but it is to say when you have a limited amount of political capital, as we all do, because we have a limited amount of time and resource, you have to choose what you spend it on. And I chose to spend it on housing people and trying to get food out to people. But the naivety comes in your question in failing to recognise the difference between what it means to be a politician, what it means to be a black politician dealing with race issues.
Sure.
And this is why I keep stressing the importance of getting a diversity of worldview in our newsrooms as well. And this is not a dig. This is a gentle challenge that we all have to take on. We need that diversity in politics. We need it in the newsroom so that the questions can be better informed.
Yeah, I think we're working hard on diversity in our newsrooms, and I think we're publicising those views extensively on a regular basis.
That's great to know.
But maybe you'd like to take it up with our head of news or something. Maybe there's a conversation to be had around that. That would be really good and progressive and interesting, I think.
You'd like me to talk to your head of news about your recruitment, you're saying?
No, not about my recruitment. No, about the dialogue going forward, as you've mentioned.
Okay.
On BBC and ITV, that journalists should be doing a better job. But what about the references to Colston and slavery around around Bristol still? Do you have the ability to remove Colston's names from streets, from towers, from schools, and then the references in the streets of Bristol, like Black Boy Hill and White Ladies Road? Is that something you would prefer to see gone?
Well, I think this is an example where that history group becomes important, because White Ladies Road and Black Boy Hill, as I understand, are not actually slave references. You know, White Ladies Road is about nuns who dressed in white. Black Boy Hill is about the king. So we have to make sure that we're not peddling misunderstandings in talking about it. And that's where good quality history becomes important. And we come back to the importance of that commission, so that we can have informed views, intelligent views about our history, about how we manage our public spaces, both from their physical design to how we name them. So it's not for me to, again, you know, this is an issue that's come up, but I go back to the first point that we just shared. Because the statue is being torn down, and we as a city have to find out a way of how we come off the back of that with unity and togetherness with all the difference. But I still have issues of substance I need to deal with limited number of hours in the day and limited resource. We have an £80 million hole in the budget resulting from COVID, the increase in costs, loss of revenue, and the shortfall in government finance. We still have a housing crisis. We're still trying to make sure that we secure the investment we need for the redevelopment of Temple Meads, and our mass transit system. We've launched the Western Gateway, 4.4 million people in that economic area to really drive our economic prospects. I was on a call yesterday with the Future of Aerospace with Unite the Union, and we're looking at phenomenal numbers of job losses if we don't win the investment, the government support we need for our aerospace industry, with the potential of that industry moving over to France because the French government are offering that level of support. So, you know, if I think, what am I going to be doing, in my future, again, in the issues of substance to which I will lend my time, it will be on those economic employment and housing issues. I don't have at the top of my priority changing street names. But having said that, if as a result of the work of this commission, the city decides that it's a priority for it to reassess, reevaluate its relationship to its public space and its names, then that's a conversation, I would support.
So just to be clear, sorry to take that up the meeting, just once you've had these discussions with academics, historians, I anticipate will make recommendations, and then will you intend to take those to the city? I don't know how you get the public's input to that.
Well, the academics and the historians will also talk to the public. It's not my club. That's the point I was making. You know, I talk to them, we ask them to do it, and then what we would ideally engaging with some public history. You know, and as I said to Ellie at the beginning, you know, one of the great opportunities is for a piece of work looking at Bristol's history, understanding Bristol's history, is to engage with our schools, our community groups. We got community history groups all over the city, over in Brislington, Eastern, the Bristol Radical History Group. There are lots of groups that look at Bristol's history and try to bring some understanding as to what went before. And we've got that fantastic documentary at the moment with David Little Sugar, just about the 1831 riots. Again, just learning about our history and who we are and how we became who we are. That needs to be done with the city. It's the best place for history to be done in the public domain.
Yeah, you don't anticipate a public vote as such. There's not going to be any need for saying...
You mean like an EU referendum?
Here's your four options to do. What should we do with the area there? I don't know.
How do a public conversation and come out the other end of it? I hope it wouldn't end up as blunt as a public vote, what should we name this bridge, Boatface or something like that. That's, we don't want to do it. I it's time for a little bit of nuance and sophistication in the way we talk to ourselves. So hopefully it'll be more of an iterative process, a collective, collaborative process. I don't want to anticipate, how you come out the other end of it. We're all learning about ourselves all the time. We're learning about the city and how it functions.
Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Pete, are you actually on the line? I'm not sure if you wanted to ask a question.
Yes, I do, please, if that's all right.
Of course.
Sorry you can't see me. I don't have a camera, which is probably a blessing. Hi, Marvin. Hi, everyone. Which groups have you spoken to, Marvin, about ownership, potential ownership, if it's not Bristol City Council?
I want to be a bit wary of that, Pete, at the minute. Not for my sake, but because I don't want to embarrass anyone. But what I would say is these are some of the societies, organisations that many of us would associate with Bristol's establishment. And some of them would be, we would associate them directly with Colston and his legacy. Whether they feel comfortable with that heritage or not, they would be organisations that, that would commonly be associated with Edward Colston.
And have they expressed any views to you or a uniform view as to what happened on Sunday if they are the potential owners?
I think the view, the key point they're making is that the priority from here on out is to build for the future and to find a way of bringing the city together. In some sense, some of what I said to you at the beginning was, you know, I think that anyway, but it was also partly informed and confirmed by what they were sharing. One of the phrases used was that we have a discontinuity at the moment in Bristol's story with the statue being pulled down, and we need to work out what we do with that discontinuity. And we can work for a positive outcome. That is the priority, to work for that positive outcome for in the future of Bristol relations, how we manage that public space and how we manage the future of the statue.
Okay. Just picking up on the question Richard asked, I don't know if you heard the criminal barrister on Radio Bristol this morning, but I guess there is a point to be made that if there is a charge of damage to a listed building, which the Colston statue was, then it's very likely that, you know, Bristol City Council will have to make a statement or indeed front a prosecution. So I know you don't want to sort of get embroiled in any potential court case and the ramifications of that. But can I just ask, as mayor, you'll be willing to do that to assist the police in any investigation into people who've committed a potential crime and provide a statement as per necessary to assist in any investigation?
Sounds like you've written a script, Pete.
had a long time to come up with my questions.
There's a great story in that for you, isn't there? this is my priorities. What I'll share with you is not what will happen. I'll share with you the principles, right? We've got a good relationship with the police. And by the way, just for the record, I've said it repeatedly, I think the way they handled Sunday was outstanding. It was wise policing. It was ego-free policing. And it was intelligent, locally informed policing, which meant that we didn't have a big tear up in the middle of the city with loads of smashed windows. But the outcome is the evidence. So we will work closely with our police. Right? Our priority is how we come out the other side. Everything else is secondary to that, how we manage the city. And I cannot and I will not condone criminal damage. I just cannot and I will not. But what I would always say is it's the common good that is what we want to get to here. How do we manage our future? And I will have those principles inform my response. And obviously there's a key bit of information in who has ownership of the statue to come, but I will have my approach informed by those principles, and I'll also have my approach informed by what our city partners talk to me, including some of these organisations, what they share with me about what they think is the best way forward for Bristol.
I guess you can't be in a situation though, can you, as an elected mayor, where you can't engage with a criminal investigation. That wouldn't work for you, would it?
No, I mean, I have to uphold law and you know, I have to uphold order. But law and order is a means to an end. They're not ends in themselves. They are means to a better society. So actually what we're pointing at is what they're there for. And then our aim is to work with those systems, the criminal justice system, our social system, to get us to the end. There is a way of working with those systems that don't actually give you the ends that you're trying to get to. And we want to be more sophisticated as a city than that, and that's what where those conversations are right now.
Okay, just final question on this specifically. You said about, you know, taking the appropriate advice. Would the final decision on something like this be for the head of legal, or would it be yours?
Well, it would be the CPS ultimately. making that decision. So one is at the back confirming, you know, that there is a case of criminal damage, and you know it's on camera and so forth. The next is it in the public interest to go ahead with the prosecution? And again, there are various barristers' opinions around. I read a really interesting blog today. They're saying you could argue it either way, and many people would try to argue it, but that barrister was thinking on balance. They think, you know, the case would be made. It would be hard. It would be pushing uphill to say it wasn't in the public interest, just because of the clinical nature. You know, if you were to take it out of context, you know, just what happened. But as I keep saying, Pete, you know, I'm not trying to be. I'm just being very careful because of the sub judice. But what I want to do is lay out the principles that will shape our decision, and actually that we will not do this alone. We will do this with other city institutions and the city leaders, because this is about the city's collective future.
Okay. And just a very couple of quick final questions. In terms of getting the statue back up, do you have any time scales yet, or any idea of how much of cost? And you said it will go into one of the museums. Do you know which one?
I'm going to work that. We're going to work that out. Time scales. We just need to locate a diver, Pete, the technical equipment. That work's being done now, and we're getting timeframes on it. And I'm sure we'll let you know in due course.
Okay, and final question for now, just in terms of the plinth that's left and the space. You talked about sort of having to engage the whole city in any sort of decision about that. Your deputy mayor has made it quite clear and has tweeted out that you know, Bristol's black community will be front and center of those discussions. And I guess this sort of speaks to what Richard was asking. If you do ask for a whole citywide conversation, you often get back an answer that you don't like, as in democracy, perhaps with, I don't know, as a Labour MP, you presumably didn't agree with, or in fact, I know you didn't agree with Brexit or the last general election. So you've got a bit of a conundrum there, haven't you?
It's a city with lots of different views, and that's the point I've been making. You know, because we have contrasting views as a politician who wants to lead a city, it means you have to find a way of relating to all those views and respecting them, even if you don't understand them, or making sure people know they're respected, even if you don't pursue their view. And that's the art of the leadership. Otherwise, you end up going down some Trumpian tunnel in which you're trying to demonize our, you know, some of your population, play up to your base, dividing your country. We don't want that within the city. Asher's right. You know, the black community do need to be front and center. And this was an expression. But when there's plenty of places front and center for other people to be too. I think this is a story. This is a story of dispossessed people in general, and certainly we need white working class people to be front and center of that discussion as well. This is a city. This is about the city's relationship. And you've heard already that I've been talking to other establishment organisations within the city about that future. We'll have the historians involved in helping us get an understanding and get some of that raw material that inform decision we make. So there'll be lots of people involved.
Okay, that's all I need. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Pete. Paul, I'm sure you'd rather ask your questions in a minute downstairs. Cool. Just quickly, Adam, you didn't have anything else you wanted to clarify or check?
I think that's pretty comprehensive.
Super. Thank you, everyone. We have recorded, and Caitlin will get that posted up as soon as possible for you all, and we'll follow up anything else you have. Thanks very much for your time.